Students, this is the continuation of my lecture series on Joseph Andrews, written by Henry Fielding. Students, this novel is divided into four books, and each book has several chapters. Each book has, average from 15 to 18 chapters. In his preface to this novel, Henry Fielding mentions that this is comic epic in prose. You know, in my earlier lectures, I talked about this point, okay, comic epic in prose. Here, Henry Fielding has also differentiated, in the prefatory chapter, he differentiated his comic epic in prose from both comic romance and a serious romance. Fielding also tells us that, like an epic, his comic epic in prose embraces dignity and seriousness of purpose. It is epical in scale, and it is comic because it is highly down to earth realistic. In other words, this novel, a comic epic, promises a variety of characters involved in a comprehensive action with an epical length. In this novel, the element of humor occupies a very prominent place. In this book, in the beginning of the book, we find the introduction of Joseph Andrews and Mr. Abraham Adams. Joseph Andrews is a tall and handsome son of poor Gaffar and Gammer Andrews. So, Mr. Gaffar Andrews and Mrs. Gammer Andrews are the parents of Joseph. His sister Pamela got married to the nephew of Sir Thomas Booby few years ago. Joseph was given a job of a footman, a servant by Sir Thomas Booby in his country parish. There are several farms of Sir Thomas Booby, in a countryside, in the village. After doing a few odd jobs like keeping birds, watching pet dogs, Joseph soon became a good horse rider. He also won several races for his master, Sir Thomas Booby. When Joseph was 17, he attracted the attention of Lady Booby. Lady Booby tries to seduce him indirectly, but Joseph is so innocent that he cannot understand the malicious intentions of Lady Booby. Joseph often visited church for prayers. In the church, Joseph was being observed by Parson Abraham Adams. Here, Abraham Adams started to teach and preach Joseph, religious and moral virtues. Parson Adams is a very good scholar of the Greek and Latin languages. Adams has also a good command over French, Italian, and Spanish languages. However, he is a simple and innocent man of good nature. Mr. Adams is generous, friendly, and also a brave man, a strong man. He wanted to make Joseph a true a Christian with moral virtue. But unfortunately, before he can start Joseph on a course of Latin instruction, Mr. and Mrs. Booby depart the village for London City. And not only that, they take Joseph with them. So here Joseph is overwhelmed by City Life in London. Lady Booby tries to trap him several times for, you know, physical relationship directly or indirectly, but in vain. He remains uncorrupted. That leads to Lady Booby's anger. Here, students, Joseph falls in with a fast crowd of urban footmen, but you know, he also wants to live you know, a very prosperous life. He has his dreams. Okay. On the other hand, you know, Lady Booby is trying to seduce him. Lady Booby, you know, is a lusty woman. So here, after a few months in London, Lady Booby's husband, Sir Thomas, dies. Now she is free to make attempts on the footman's virtue. Joseph fails to respond to her amorous hints. You know, he cannot understand the, you know, indirect hints of Lady Booby to have physical relationship with her. However, you know, because he is innocent, so he cannot understand properly, okay, the indirect invitations of Lady Booby. One day, in a letter to his sister Pamela, he indicates his belief that no woman of Lady Booby's social stature could possibly be attracted to, you know, poor servant like him. Soon, Joseph endures another attempt at seduction by another lady, Mrs. Slipslop. This lady, Mrs. Slipslop, is maid servant of Lady Booby. She is a middle-aged and, you know, hideous woman. Now, Lady Booby one day calls Joseph and tries again to seduce him, but Joseph rejects her proposal. She becomes angry due to his virtuous attitude. So she sends him away again, and you know, decided to terminate the employment of Joseph. In other words, she you know, decides to fire Joseph from his job. She then suffers agonies of indecision over whether to retain Joseph or not. You know, she is very much impressed by the you know, personality of Joseph. So by hook or crook, she wants to possess him. But here Joseph has, you know, moral value, moral values with him, and the teachings of his friend Mr. Abraham Adams. So he can defend himself, right? And he is loyal to his fiance Fanny Goodwill. About, you know, we'll see Fanny Goodwill later. Eventually, you know, Joseph receives his wages and his working papers from the manager of Lady Booby, namely Peter Pounds. In fact, actually, Joseph is relieved to have been dismissed, because he has now realized that his mistress is both lascivious and psychologically unhinged. Okay, lascivious means lusty, and you know, she has psychic disorder. In the course of time, after that, now this jobless Joseph is moving towards his village. He has decided to go back to his village, you know, to country parish. But during his journey, Joseph is attacked by some road ruffians, some robbers. Here, students, Joseph now you know, sets out for the Boobies country parish, where he will reunite with his childhood sweetheart and now fiance, the illiterate maid, milkmaid Fanny Goodwill. So this is the purpose of Joseph, that he will meet his beloved Fanny Goodwill in the village. So here Joseph, on his first night, out, he runs into two ruffians who beat, you know, strip and rob him and leave him in a ditch to die. Soon a stagecoach approaches, you know, some passengers are going by, and you know, in that coach there are several wealthy people full of hypocritical and self-interested passengers, and they admit Joseph into the coach. But earlier, when they see Joseph, you know, almost naked, they are not ready to help this poor man. But when a lawyer among them argues that they may be liable for Joseph's death if they make no effort to help him, and he would die, the coach takes Joseph and the other passengers to a nearby guest house, where the there is a maid servant named Betty, who cares for Joseph, and a surgeon pronounces his injuries, which are likely mortal. Moving ahead in the plot, now students, you can see in the slide, here Joseph defies the surgeon's prognosis the next day, receiving a visit from Mr. Barnabas, the clergyman, and some wretched hospitality from Mrs. Tovehouse, you know, Mrs. Tovehouse, the wife of the innkeeper, the owner of the guest house. Soon another clergyman arrives at the inn and turns out to be Mr. Adams. Here, Mr. Adams is on his way to London to attempt to publish several volumes of his sermons. Students, sermons means in Gujarati, vyakhyan. Okay, so he wants to publish his sermons. That's why he is going to London. Joseph is excited to see him, and Adams treats his penniless disciple to several meals. You know, students, remember that Joseph is now penniless. He doesn't have, you know, a penny to pay any bill. Adams helps him to pay his bills, and also he supports him. Adams is not is also not having more money, but he soon finds himself trying unsuccessfully to get a loan from Mr. Tovhaus, with a volume of his sermons as security. Here Mr. Tovhaus is a good man. He is trying to help Mr. Adams, but Mrs. Tovhaus, his wife, is frugal, is a nagging wife. So she prevents her husband to help Mr. Adams. Now soon Mr. Barnabas, hearing that Adams is a clergyman, introduces him to a bookseller who might agree to represent him in the London publishing trade. The bookseller is not interested in marketing sermons, however, and soon the fruitless discussion is interrupted by an uproar elsewhere in the guest house. Here, Betty, now remember, students, the chambermaid or maid servant of Mr. Tovhaus, she is having a love affair with her master, Mr. Tovhaus, and on the other hand, she is also trying to seduce Joseph, while applying some medicines over the wounds of Joseph. She is also very much impressed by the look of Joseph. But here these people, hear the uproar, and this noise is coming from the guest house. Betty, having been rejected by Joseph, she has just been discovered in bed with Mr. Tovhaus. Now, students, let's move to book 2. Okay. Let me clear one point here, that this novel is divided into 4 books. Okay. So each book has several chapters. In book 1, you have 18 chapters, and now in the second book, you have 17 chapters. Now, in the beginning of the second book, we can see that here Joseph and Mr. Adams departs. Okay, they departs from the guest house, and they continue their journey towards towards their village. Mr. Adams discovers that he has left his sermons at home and thus has no reason to go to London. Students, Mr. Adams ends up getting a loan from a servant from a passing coach, and he and Joseph are about to part ways when he discovers that he has left his sermons at home, and that's why he doesn't have any reason to go to London. Adams and Joseph decide to take turns riding Adams' horse on their journey home, and after a rocky start, they are well on their way, with Adams riding in a stagecoach and Joseph riding the horse. In the coach, Mr. Adams listens avidly to a gossipy tale about a jilted woman named Leonora. At the next rest house, he and Adams and Joseph get into get into there, but they are insulted by the innkeeper and his wife. When they depart the inn with Joseph in the coach and Adams, theoretically on horseback, the absent-minded Adams unfortunately forgets about the horse and ends up going on foot. Here, students, then next day, the absent-minded Adams is lost in jungle and Joseph becomes alone. Adams happens to meet sportsman while he is walking on the road. Now, Adams is alone, you know. Sorry. On his solitary walk, you know, solitary means now he is alone. So, on his solitary walk, Adams encounters a sportsman who is out shooting birds and who, you know, is praising himself, is blowing his own trumpet. So he boasts of the great value, you know, he places on bravery. He has a gun, you know. When the sound of woman's cries reaches them, however, the sportsman, you know, runs away with his gun, leaving Adams to rescue that woman from her assailant. The athletic Adams administers, his strong will, and he is able to save that girl. As students, you know, here Adams is a clergyman. He is a, you know, priest, but he is a very strong man. In this novel, we find more adventures of Adams than that of Joseph. Here, he rescues that girl. He saves her from her attackers. Then, Adams recognize the girl. They knew each other. She is Fanny Goodwill. Here Adams, you know, while beating that attacker, some young men are passing by. When a group of young men, when a group of young men comes by, however, the assailant suddenly recovers and accuses Adams and the woman of robbing and beating him, you know. So here that assailant counter complains to those young men that he has been robbed by Adams and Fanny. Now these young men lay hold of Adams and Fanny and drag them to the justice of the peace. Students, here let me clear one point, that during those days, justice of the peace, is supposed to take decisions, you know, is supposed to have a, you know, to take trials, to take trials of criminals. So here these young men, you know, hope that they would get a reward for, turning them in, you know, for these, for getting these criminals to the justice. On the way, Mr. Adams and the woman, means Fanny, discovered that, you know, that they miss Joseph, because here when Adams asks Fanny about her purpose of journey, she let him know that she actually is is in search of Joseph. She has heard about the attack made on Joseph, and that's why she has been worried about Joseph. So here Fanny is on her journey to find Joseph. Students, then what happened? The justice of the peace is not a responsible official. He is negligent and is about to commit Adams and Fanny to prison without giving their case much thought, when suddenly a bystander recognizes Adams and he also tells the justice that he knows Mr. Adams. He is clergyman, okay, clergy and gentleman. So the justice of the peace readily reverses himself and dismisses the charges against Adams and Fanny. Soon Adams and Fanny depart for the next inn, the next guest house, where they expect to meet Joseph. Students, here Joseph and Fanny have a joyous reunion at this guest house, and Joseph wishes to get married then and there. At that time Joseph is also worried about Fanny, because when Adams tells him that she has been attacked by assailant, so Joseph wants to marry Fanny as early as possible. But both Mr. Adams and Fanny prefer a more patient approach. Mr. Adams is of the opinion that Joseph has to wait for some days, and that is not the proper time to get married. In the morning, the companions discover that they have another inn bill, the bill of that guest house, but they cannot pay. So Adams, he goes off in search of the wealthy parson of the parish, okay, because he knew Parson Truliber, okay, and he was living there. Unfortunately, Parson Truliber is a greedy man. He spends most of his time tending his hogs rather than tending souls, because the parson is supposed to give moral preachings to people. Okay, he is a man of materialistic mind, but a parson is a is a person who has several religious duties to be performed. Here Truliber reacts badly to Adam's request for charity. Adams returns to the inn, he returns to the guest house with nothing to show for his efforts, but fortunately a generous peddler hears of the traveler's predicament and he pays the money, for the bills of the guest house. Then, after a couple more miles on the road, the travelers encounter, a gregarious squire who offers them generous hospitality. Here, gregarious means, in Gujarati, say juthwadi. Okay. Here, he also gives his coach to Mr. Adams, Joseph, and Fanny. But then, he retracts these offers at the last minute. This is ridiculous, right? Adams discusses this strange behavior of this squire with the innkeeper, and that innkeeper tells him about the squire's long history of making false promises. Okay. Now this is the end of the book 2.